Hello and welcome. Here we have an Elgin wristwatch that I picked up at a local thrift store for $3. It was sold as non-running. I'm not sure what's wrong with it. I'm not sure if there's anything broken, but let's open it up and find out. I've got the case back loosened here, so let's get the case off. The dial definitely looks like it's seen some better days, but it's not in too rough shape. Let's take a look at the movement. Well, not so bad at first glance. I'm not seeing anything glaringly wrong. There wasn't anything wrong with the balance. It looked like the pivots were okay. So let's get the hands off. Having a look at this, there's some kind of gunky stuff all over this gray stuff. I'm not sure if it's an adhesive, some kind of putty, something to keep it from rattling around in the case, I'm not sure. But it seems to have gotten all over the place. I'm working on getting the dial screws out here. And the dial just doesn't want to seem to budge. I'm trying to very gently pry it up here with the screwdriver. The dial screws are more than loose enough, and it just does not want to move. But we'll come back once I get it off. And after some careful prying, it did finally come loose. Looks like the dial feet were a little bit corroded, but nothing too bad. We'll set that aside. And let's take a look at the dial side of the movement here. Again, more of this kind of gunky stuff. And there's some stuff on this little dial washer. Just get a better look at it. It's just kind of gross. But we'll get this all disassembled and cleaned up. And let's start getting this disassembled. We'll start with that dial washer. And then the hour hand. And now we'll take this little cover plate out. That's covering the minute wheel and some intermediate wheels. And the first few minutes of this are going to be a little bit shaky, a little bit more zoomed in than I would have liked. Was having some technical difficulties with my camera, but that resolves itself a little bit later on. There's that cover plate. And there's one of the intermediate wheels. And the second one. I'm just getting a good look at those so that I can remember which one goes where. They're not exactly the same. And there goes the minute wheel. Next, we're going to remove the canyon pinion. That came off no problem. And now before we get too deep into it, we're going to remove the balance just to be safe. I'm still very new at this. I have slipped with the screwdriver a handful of times, and the last thing I need to do is damage that hairspring by doing something careless. And the balance seemed like it wanted to move. Maybe we'll get lucky and this will just need a good service and nothing more. Taking a look at the pivots. And next, before we move any further, we're going to let down the mainspring. This will make sure that there's no residual power in there causing anything to go flying when we start disassembling. And we can do this pretty easily by just moving the click out of the way and holding on to the crown and letting it down gently. And a lot of these screws seem to have been much more stubborn than I was expecting, but hopefully nothing a good cleaning won't take care of. And here comes the ratchet wheel. And next we have the crown wheel. And this one is a little bit different in that the screw itself is reverse threaded. So we just need to make sure that we're not turning it the right way. And I am hesitating here, it's giving me a lot of resistance. And I don't really want to bear down on it too much, but I might have to just to get it out. And there we go. It finally budged. And I slipped. Let's make sure we still have everything. There's a little washer that sits inside the crown wheel. There is the screw for the crown wheel. And the crown wheel itself. Next, we're going to remove the click. And the click spring in this is another piece that just sits right below it, and it's got its own very, very tiny screw. Next, on to the barrel bridge. There are three screws that hold this in place. I'm going to get them all loosened up and then I'll just remove the whole thing at once. Next, we can remove the center wheel. And the mainspring barrel. We'll open that up in a few minutes. And I'm attempting to get this setting lever screw out. It's engaged with the setting lever that's on the opposite side. And I just can't seem to move it. I'm afraid to put any more pressure or really bear down on it. Everything in here seems to be just kind of gunked up. So I'm going to move on to the train wheel bridge. This one covers the fourth wheel and the escape wheel. And everything's giving me just a little bit more resistance than I would like. I'm just holding the movement steady here. It was actually just starting to come loose from the movement holder. So let's get that secured. And now we can get the train wheel bridge off. Not a lot of jewels on here. I think this was supposed to be a 7 jewel, but I was only seeing 4 or 5. So it's possible that this was serviced at a later date, the jewels were broken, and they were replaced by these little brass pivot holes instead. The train of wheels looks pretty good. Here's the escape wheel. Next up is the pallet fork bridge and the pallet fork itself. This one was really stuck. Just trying to get at it from just about any angle where I'm not too much in danger of damaging the pallet fork itself. It is very, very tiny. And I'm finally able to pry it loose right here. And out comes the pallet fork. Now back out to the setting lever and the yoke and yoke spring. This is the yoke right here, along with the yoke spring. These screws, just like the rest of the screws in this movement, are pretty well lodged in there. You can see I'm putting an uncomfortable amount of pressure trying to get these off. And just making sure it doesn't go flying away. It is engaged right there with the setting lever. And there goes the yoke. Everything looks to be okay here, so I'm going to give it another go on the other side of the movement, trying to get that setting lever screw out. Threaded right into that spot that I was just poking at. And once this comes free, that should just drop out down the other side of the movement onto the workbench. And fast forward, I finally was able to get it to budge. But not quite enough. So let's try and get everything else out. Here is the crown and the stem. And this is part of the keyless works here. Still doesn't want to budge. Everything seems to be fine. It doesn't seem to be stuck on anything. It's just really lodged in there. Stem looks okay, and this is the sliding clutch and the clutch wheel stuck together. I think this really just needs a good service. I didn't see anything horribly wrong with everything, and it's just gunked up. And I was finally able to get that setting lever screw to move, and there is the setting lever, covered in more of that gunk. And yuck. Ollie will give this a good cleaning, and hopefully that'll be all she needs. Here's a look at the base plate. You can see there are very few jewels. There's one on that side. And that's it. There's just one jewel in there. Here we have the mainspring barrel. We'll get this open, take a look at the spring. Being, again, a little bit stubborn, but you don't necessarily want this to be coming loose super easily. Just gonna be careful when I pull the top plate off, or the top cover. And it's now free from the barrel arbor. Let's get the barrel arbor out of here. This is what engages with the spring to actually wind it. When you turn the crown, it turns the crown wheel and the ratchet wheel. The ratchet wheel is sitting directly above this. And there's a little notch in this that spins around the spring and winds it all up. And let's get the mainspring out of here. Looks like an old one. The new mainsprings are not this carbon steel color, they're not this blued steel, and they are also more S-shaped, gives them a little bit more power. And this is just nice concentric circles. This movement is from the late 1920s or early 30s. There's a chance that this is the original mainspring still. It does look like it's in good shape, and I will probably just reuse it. And like everything else, it was pretty well stuck. Doesn't look overly out of shape. Looks pretty good. And here is the watch completely disassembled. There's not too much to it. So now we can take all these parts out and start cleaning them. But before we do that, there is one jewel that is on top of the balance bridge right here. And to clean this one and to oil it, we're going to need to disengage the hairspring and the balance itself. So there's a very tiny screw here that acts just like a little, it just pinches that tiny little piece there. So I'm just trying to very slowly work this out. It's a little bit difficult to do this while filming it as well. I normally have my face very close to this with a higher magnification. But once I figure out a more permanent camera setup, I should be able to do this a little bit more like I normally would. So just poking that through, being very careful with the balance, making sure that I'm not doing any damage to the hairspring. I just gotta get the hairspring disengaged from the little regulator. Now it's, there it is. And this looks good too. If I can get it in focus. There we go. Hairspring looks good, the pivots on the balance staff look good, the impulse jewel looks good. it's time for cleaning. I'm going to take all of the components that can withstand an ultrasonic cleaner and get them in these little baskets and clean them with the ultrasonic. The major pieces that I won't be throwing in the ultrasonic are mainly the pallet fork and the balance with the hairspring. Those both have really delicate parts, and they also have jewels that are secured with a shellac, and running them through the alcohol, the 99% alcohol that I have in my ultrasonic would completely just dissolve that shellac and the jewels would fall out. So just taking a look at this case, here's more of that gunk. There is just a big glob of it right there. I think that's pretty loose too. Ugh. I'm not sure what this stuff is, why it's all inside everywhere. I'm not sure if it's some kind of adhesive, but we gotta get it out of here. So I'm just using some Q-tips, some just pointed Q-tips with some water at first, and then a little bit of alcohol just to get everything in there and get under the crevices. And now on to the ultrasonic. I'm not doing anything fancy here. I don't have any watch cleaning chemicals. I am using just a jewelry cleaner to start. And then once the jewelry cleaner cycle is done, then I'll do a series of baths in 99% isopropyl alcohol. It seems to do a pretty good job of not only degreasing, but just rinsing really well, getting everything nice and shiny. So once everything's been in the jewelry cleaner bath, I'm going to give it a manual rinse in just this other container full of isopropyl alcohol before I drop it into the other one. I just wanted to make sure there's no residual water. I don't want to dilute the baths that I have there, so I'm just kind of using that as a staging area, getting everything initially cleaned off. And I'm going to do 10 minutes with each cycle, and I have 3 baths of isopropyl alcohol. And I'm just cycling them through the jars. Everything is pretty small, and the majority of the components fit in these 2 little baskets. So I'm not shuffling around too much as I'm trying to clean this. It's really just those, a couple of the bridges, and the mainspring itself, which I'm trying to be careful with. And here we have all the parts laid out. Nice and clean, nice and shiny, after having their bath. And now let's take a look at the dial. I'm not going to do anything too crazy with this. I'm just going to rub it down with some water very gently. I did, after rubbing it down with some water, do a spot check on the part of the dial with some alcohol, and that seemed to work pretty well and didn't make any marks, so I did give it a quick rinse with the alcohol too. And here we have the balance bridge. I could not get a video of getting those screws out. They are so ridiculously tiny, but I did finally get them out under some magnification, and here we are just popping out the jewels. A more modern movement wouldn't require you to fully disassemble the balance like this. There are springs that you can move out, and this one unfortunately does not. And these are just how small those screws were. They are so small they don't even want to focus. And now I am oiling the jewels in the for the balance. I'm trying to be as careful and as steady as I can be. It wasn't the perfect application here. It was decent. I ended up dropping it and having to apply this about 4 or 5 times. And just again for size comparison, that is the head of a straight pin, which just looks enormous compared to these jewels, and that is the pin itself. And the only other jewel that I saw in the entire movement was right here at the bottom of the balance, so I got that one disassembled and cleaned as well. And the only part that came out of the ultrasonic still looking bad was this setting lever. I scraped around with this, even attempted scraping around with my tweezers, and whatever is on here is just stuck. So it's either staining or it's just not coming off, but it's not too bad. It's mostly cosmetic. And there it goes flying because I was pressing way too hard with my tweezers. So now it's time to reassemble the mainspring barrel, putting the mainspring inside. Just have to be very careful with this. I'm not using a mainspring winder. I am just being very gentle with it. I'm taking my time and just slowly working it around. I was not trying to put any extra stress on the mainspring itself and ended up looking really good. I don't see any kinks. Very painstaking process. And now let's get the barrel arbor in. And there it goes. Just make sure that's seated correctly and get the top cover for the mainspring barrel on. That little notch in the barrel lines up with a little notch in the mainspring itself. So you just need to line those up. And got this all secured. Looks good. So let's continue on with the assembly. We're starting with the escape wheel. This one has a very, very tiny pivot, so I'm trying to be as gentle as I can be. Here is the fourth wheel. And before I get that bridge on, even though it's not completely covered, I need to get the third wheel on as well, so that it is in place. It sits just kind of under the bridge, but doesn't engage with it. And now the trick here is just to be very, very patient and very careful. The pivots need to line up in those little recesses that would normally be jewel holes. They're just those little metal divots right there. And just giving it a quick turn, hoping to help them seat, being very, very gentle, pressing down. I'm going to use a piece of wood. This is not peg wood, this is just a bamboo skewer, but it seemed to do the job okay. And there we go, it looks like things are seated pretty well. The bridge itself looks like it's down, so time to get it tacked down. And again, just trying to be as gentle as possible. These pivots are really delicate. I'm barely putting any pressure there at all. Fitting the mainspring barrel, and this is sitting kind of funny. Not sure what's going on there, but we'll come back to that. and oiling the center wheel before I put it in. I put way too much on there, so just took a little bit off. Getting that nice and situated. And again, I just have been over greasing everything today. Getting that setting lever screwed back in there. And just cleaning it up with a little bit of Rodico. And now it's time to try and fit this barrel bridge on. Trying to line it up with that setting lever screw and use that as a pivot, and then get it seated on the barrel itself. And then the last two pieces that need to engage are the center wheel and that third wheel. So again, very gentle pressure, just kind of trying to manipulate things, trying to see where they're sitting. This whole thing seems to be sitting off. We'll just keep being really gentle with it. Oh, there it goes. And you see it just slid right in there. You can see the tops of the pivots sticking through the metal settings there. And this is turning. It's turning a little hard. Harder than I would have expected. It should just fly. And it's not. But let's get it tacked down. Oops. Let's get it tacked down and we'll see what's going on here. Just trying to make sure the pivots stay engaged as I get these screws in. I'm fast forwarding through this. Okay, now giving it a little test. Turning the wheel right here, the barrel should spin everything all the way down to the escape wheel, and nothing is budging at all. What the heck? It is just stuck. Because just this tiniest bit of a turn, and nothing. So I'm having a look here. I put a little dab of grease there under the mainspring barrel, and that doesn't look like it's been touched. So the whole thing is riding a little bit high for some reason. In trying to troubleshoot this, I almost destroyed the whole thing. I thought it was actually riding way too high because of this setting being just a little bit exposed. So I pushed down on it pretty hard and ended up buckling out the other side of it, which was not the problem at all. It was actually this. This was how I got the Arbor out when I first started. And this was how I put it back in. I put it in upside down. So yeah, need to pay more attention to that next time. Here is the bridge all assembled again. Everything is finally working as expected. Putting on the crown wheel and the little washer. And after a lot of fumbling with this screw, finally got this cinched down as well. Now for the click spring. This thing is again just a little fidgety. The screw on it is so minuscule. Did that off camera. Got that all situated. And here is the click. If you're not familiar with it and you've ever wondered what actually makes the clicking sound, that very satisfying sound when you're winding up a watch, it is this engaging with the ratchet wheel. It clicks and lets it go through and does not let it go back the other way and unwind the mainspring. Just giving this a quick test. Looks good now. Here is the ratchet wheel. You'll notice that this has a square hole, and that engages right with the mainspring barrel. And some more fiddling, and there it goes. And you can see just from tightening that, everything is spinning beautifully now. All the way up to the escape wheel, it's spinning nice and fast. So time to get the pallet fork in. This is again another very delicate part and a very, very tiny pivot. You need to be very precise and also very careful. Just take your time. Looks like it's finally engaged. Now time to get the pallet fork bridge on. Same thing with this, you don't want to knock anything out of place. And of course I'm covering it up. And this one was a bit fidgety. At first I thought it was bent, but it was really just not quite seated the right way. So let's get the screw in there and see if we can get things in place after. There we go. You can see it wants to be engaged there. And there it goes. There it goes. Okay. So we are good. Tighten that down off camera. Now I tightened that and also gave the mainspring a little bit of a wind when I did that, and you'll see what we're looking for is this should just snap like that. Snap back and forth. And that moving back and forth lets the escape wheel slowly turn, which then allows the hands to turn as well, and anything else that's driven by the mainspring. Now we're getting the balance engaged. There's a little jewel inside there that needs to engage with the pallet fork. And now, if everything goes according to plan, this should just, there it goes, should just kick into life. And we have a running watch. And it looks like it just came out of position a little bit. Let's get this tightened down just a tiny bit. We're going to just turn until we feel just the tiniest bit of resistance. We are not trying to crush the pivot on these. They are very, very tiny, very delicate. So I'm just going to tighten this down until I feel just the tiniest bit of resistance. And check again. I'm going to give it a little bit of a tweak. And there we go. We're still running. So nothing's been lubricated at this point other than these two jewels. This one here that's on the top and the one that's on the bottom that's in the base plate. You can see when I push that down, it actually stopped and then it immediately kicked back up. So, looks like we are in business. I'm going to oil up the other pieces off camera. And now we can start assembling the dial side. I'm going to start with the keyless works. This is the part that allows you to both wind the watch and set the time. So I'm oiling up, actually applying a little grease to the teeth on this. This is the sliding clutch, and this engages with the crown, and it also engages with the those intermediate wheels to set the time. So these are very high friction metal on metal connections, so we're just applying a little bit of grease rather than oil here. And that looks to be seated pretty well. And I'm gonna just not use all of that grease, but just a tiniest little bit on the stem. Get that all inserted in there, make sure everything looks good. And then I'll clean up the excess as well. Now it's time for the yoke and yoke spring. And this This again has a tiny, tiny, tiny little screw that is a little bit fidgety, but isn't too bad. Get that cinched down. And we're going to slide that into place. It needs to engage with that sliding wheel right there. And you can see that keeps it springing back so that when you turn it, it's going to wind the watch. When you pull it out from that, it will then slide everything in. The setting lever will kick it over and allow you to set the time. So now I'm going to get the setting lever in here. And this engages again from the back, so I'm going to disconnect this and work that off camera. Got that all situated, and now you can see the setting lever and the yoke and yoke spring are together. Just putting a tiny little bit of lubrication where there's going to be a lot of metal on metal contact here. And starting with these intermediate wheels, these are what engage with that sliding clutch to set the time. And now getting the canyon pinion back on there. This will slide down with a nice click. You'll know that it's engaged. And the minute wheel. And that little cover plate to hold the intermediate wheels and the minute wheel in place. And just fidgeting with another comically small screw. There goes the hour wheel. And that little dial washer. And before we put the dial back on, we're just going to lubricate a little bit. And you can see when I pulled the crown out, it pushed the yoke over and it's engaged with those wheels so that those ones are turning. That's how you set the time. Then you push it back in and now it's winding the watch itself. It's winding the mainspring. So now let's get the dial back in. And I'm looking for the setting lever screws. I could not find them. I ended up having to go through, I checked my workbench, I checked the cleaning solution, and I eventually found all three in separate baths of the cleaning solution in those little jars. I'm glad I still had them and was able to recover them. Now I'm getting the hour hand back on. Click down nice and tight. And now I'm getting the minute hand back on. This one is a little bit more finicky. And that's on. Now I'm just checking setting the time. Everything feels pretty good. Looking to see what the clearance is, whether or not I'm going to have any issues with them hitting each other. They look fine. They actually look a little bit too far apart. The hour hand itself got jammed down pretty hard onto the dial, and it's resting pretty flat, and I'm worried that once I get this very, very tiny seconds hand on here, that it is going to cause problems. So let's check it out, and sure enough, yep, we are pushing. You can see it a little bit more even this way. It just, yeah, that's not good. All right, let's take the hands off and try again. Okay. After about 3 tries, I ended up taking a couple pieces of paper and putting them underneath the hour hand so that when I pushed it down, there was just a little bit of clearance and everything finally lined up as they should. Now I'm getting everything back in the case. Everything seems to fit well here. And getting this front of the case with the very well-worn crystal snapped back in. And we're done. We have a working watch. Let's check it out and see how well it keeps time. It is currently 12:51 p.m. I just set the time on here. So we will come back tomorrow and see what it looks like. Okay, so here we are almost 2 days later. I've kept it wound, but I didn't take too much notice to what time it was. It is currently reading 9:14, and it is 9:14. That's actually kind of surprising. I was not expecting it to keep time this well without any kind of additional regulation, but looks like we're only off a few seconds. And I will be getting a time grapher eventually, and we'll be able to take a more detailed look at this. And before we call this one good, we cannot leave it with this crystal. So I did order a new one, and let's get that one installed. And here we are with the new crystal. I didn't need to use any kind of special tools. Just snapped right in, surprisingly. It's in there very snug. Noticing a couple of little scuffs. I think it was just from being packaged in nothing much more than paper for the entire time. But it looks great. It looks so much better than the other one. And here we are with the finished product. It looks amazing. So much better than I had expected it to. The dial looks great. The crystal looks great. It's keeping great time. I'm just overall very surprised. This was a really fun project, and I hope to be sharing more of these very soon in the future. Thanks for watching.